sites at some point, so you can actually see, there we go. I have power like this. I love it. All right. So I'm being recorded. I'll try and keep the custom to a minimum, but I do speak Canadian, so apologies in advance. You're here for forensic theming, but I'm going to start with a little bit of context on who I am, because people often get confused at my sessions, for good reason, which we'll find out later. There are ninjas, unicorns, and firemen in this presentation, and the slides are up on SlideShare. So a bit of history for me. You can read faster than I can speak. The general sort of information that I want you to get this is that I've been around for a very long time, but active in the community for a very short period of time relative to how long I've been looking at the Drupal code base. For the most part, I work with very tiny budgets. Most of the websites that I've built over the years are less than $5,000. And so what I've done is basically taken my large-scale government experience and bootstrapped small businesses into getting on the web based on a fairly intense experience as a programmer. I'll use those in pretty big quotes because I'm not sure I would ever consider myself a programmer. Collectively, all of those websites would have been, I would say, less than 8,000 pounds, probably less than 5,000 pounds to build all of them. That's the scale I tend to work on. But I basically got really bored of building really tiny websites and have entertained myself in other ways. So these are the Drupal socks that I did. No, I won't knit you a pair, you can knit your own. That's the thing I'm not going to say, socks. I co-authored one book, been a contributing author to a second, and as of the end of September, had my first very own book. It was a much harder experience than I'd been anticipating. It's way easier to tell all the other authors that they're wrong than it is to write their own stuff. I also write workbooks, write down the magical code now, or at the end of the presentation, 45% off. I did it only because my publisher stood me, or not stood yet, but sort of embarrassed me into giving a 45% discount. I was only going to give you 15. Go. I'm now a Drupal trainer, primarily. These are the six websites that we've built so far for the site building extravaganza training program. Costs about $40 a month for this program. Registration is not open currently. It will be open at some point. And every month I build you a website and give you the complete workbook, step by step, of how I actually built that site from a Drupal install website. And again, these are the kinds of sites that I have built in the past for, I would say, depending on the era, as much as $10,000 to $15,000. But with today's technology, a lot of these can be built in less than 2 days when you know which modules to turn on and if you're not supporting IE6. So, that's the reality of the space that I work in as of today. These are also the very last slide of the presentation, so while I'm answering questions, that will all come out. Drupal trainer, blah, blah, blah. Ultimately now, I would say that I am a lazy front-end developer. I use other people's code, thank you, Drupal. I use other people's grid framework, thank you, 960. I use other people's JavaScript, thank you, jQuery, and all of those associated plugins. And I do as little of work as possible to be able to turn out these low-budget sites for businesses and not-for-profit organizations that I think are doing really interesting work. And, more importantly, for site builders who are also interested in working on projects of the same scale. A lot of what I'm talking about came in at the very tail end of Jason's presentation. I'm not sure if Jason's stuck around. Maybe, maybe not. This stuff doesn't do well under very, very high loads, but if you're getting in the range of a few thousand visitors a month, how many people are in the absolute beginner session and they're getting millions of page views a month? Like two people, three 30 maybe. Most of this is going to be in a smaller scale if you're still at the beginner level. So that's where I spent a lot of my time. And ultimately, the reason why I spent more time at this end of the spectrum is because of the way Drupal treats. I'm going to take all the people out of it and blame the software itself. Because of the way Drupal treats code from both the core and contrib point of view. So at first you sort of think, dead easy. I'm just going to copy this one little template file. I'm just going to put it in my theme. It's going to be super easy. Just going to change this, like, one little thing. Then you realize that there's maybe a module file that hard-coded some stuff that maybe you weren't expecting. And then you realize that you're hacking core. Okay. So what I'm trying to show you is not necessarily a best practice. It's how to prevent your website from catching on fire and taking out the entire neighborhood with all of the editing that you need to do on all of the template files, and then realizing that the module, the contrib module that you grab, doesn't actually use the theme system because everything is hard-coded in. Does anyone understand this? Can you guys go, I'm afraid, but I don't care. It's like three people at the back. So let me just say that it can get this bad very quickly if you try to desperately care about your markup, and we will get to those of you who desperately care about your markup. This presentation is not about the following things. This is where confusion can sometimes set in, because people think, I'm going to go to that because I want to learn stuff. And then she puts up friggin' pictures of Rick Astley, which you've already seen, whether you do it or not. So this presentation is not about all of these kinds of things. And if you want this level of information, this kind of detail, leave now and go to one of these sessions instead. These are the advanced theming sessions. And also go backwards in time and listen to anything that John Adam has done at this conference and Jason's on responsive design. Oh, and I've already taken the last one, but go to W. Smith, right when you call your magazine section. And buy this issue of .NET Magazine. The stand here, I told him to bring boxes of free magazines. He's not here, he won't admit. So this one has an article by Steve Fisher and another one by Jen Simmons that are Drupal specific. Great magazine generally, but this issue specifically is good. No, you can't have mine, you have to go and get your own. I'm going to change this. You taking a picture now? You good? So, forensic theming is not about best practices, it's about how to actually take a look at your theme once it's a Drupal website to figure out how to change that one little thing over in the corner without having to set your entire website on fire. Basically, four things that we're going to go through. Tools for forensic theming. I use Fever in a very weird way. Then we're going to look at theming tools, very quick. I'll basically show you a slide and tell you to use each of those things. I will run you through an actual theme build as stills, like they will be screenshots. And then we'll do a summary. Should I happen to have any time left at the end, which I'm not expecting, we will do potentially 3 out of 4 of my demos never work, but let's try it anyways. I won't tell you why we're not going to do the fourth this year. So that's basically what we're going to cover. Again, if this is not what you're expecting, I won't be insulted, but I like getting really good session reviews, so, you know, just push off if you're not going to give me a good session review because you want some of the other things that I won't be talking about. Here we go, the crime. In my experience, working with Drupal markup can be a bit of a crime. And I mean a crime in the sense of this is the crime scene that you're working with. And trying to decipher exactly what happened and who did what and why all of this nonsense is appearing on your page can be really frustrating if you don't have tools that are designed to do essentially line by line analysis or thinking about how these things come together. And I've tweeted a couple of times that I won't do shadow puppets, but I do really like to be able to touch the code. So if you happen to be able to read some of the line numbers, when we talk about crime, when I talk about crime scene investigation, 161, which is the very top line, those body classes give you a lot of clues about what kind of page you're looking at, and therefore which modules may be responsible. So without even having to use any kind of special tools, you can take a look at the markup that's being spit out and often tell something about how this Drupal page is being constructed. Down towards the bottom, looking at the rendered page, not going into the code base to try and guess at how these code fragments ended up getting stitched together to make a rendered page. So it's, for some people, it's a really different way of looking at a code base to look at the output and get the clues from the output instead of repping through files, repping, searching, whatever the English word is for people who don't. So anyway, two types of clues that we're going to work with. One is to look exclusively at the rendered page, and there's two tools that we'll use for this, Sweeper and Firebug. And then the second is to do essentially crime lab forensics. And this is, in my crazy little analogy world, it's reconstructing the crime scene by poking at it and forcing Drupal to say, from the rendered page. It's two ways of doing this. Gives different kinds of information. Let's take a look at our crime scene first. So we'll be looking at rendered pages, and ultimately, you're only looking at the effects of what Drupal has done. You can't look at Drupal, it's just an HTML page. Start with Sweeper. And one of the things that I found in all of the training that I've been doing is that newcomers to Drupal have a really hard time seeing selectors that they can work with. And I'm asking myself, these slides are already online. You don't need to write any of this stuff down. So by the way, you go to slideshare.net/emmajane. They're already up there. I mean, you're welcome to write things in, but you don't need to. So they have a really hard time identifying how to pick out one little selector from the masses and masses and masses of junk that gets output from Drupal and Drupal's modules. So with Sweeper, which is very similar to the Drupal Gardens point-and-click scanning tool, once it's turned on, so once it's enabled and turned on, you get this little pop-up window at the bottom of your screen, and you click on things, and when you click on the thing, you can manipulate the object visually. So I turned, if you look at the middle arrow, I've turned it orange in this case. And then I can look at the CSS selector, and I can look at how that gets applied throughout my site. Perhaps this is obvious, but don't do this on production websites. This is more for development purposes. Right, so you publish and save this theme, and then you navigate through your website, and you decide whether or not, so then you update your theme in the style sheet. Sweeper does that for you. So you've published it, you go through, and you take a look. Is this visually what I want to accomplish? Or do I need to change my selector? So for example, heading level 2 on a teaser is actually inside a link, so if you want to change the color of heading level 2 on a teaser list, you also have to get the link. Sweeper helps you pick the best CSS selector, which you can then take, apply whatever kinds of properties you want. So maybe you're also going to add font style, maybe you're going to add line height, maybe you're can visually see what will be changed, then grab the selector from the far right, take it back over to your theme file, and actually edit what gets pushed out to production, knowing that throughout your site, you should have the right item flagged for style throughout. This isn't the way we were intended, I'm sure, for their module to be used, but I think it's great. The black line in the middle of the screen gives you the path of all of the nested div classes, whatever happens to be, up to the end point that you've clicked. So if you want to generalize the style that you're applying, you can basically move up that path, click on that item again, apply a style, and see how that looks in your website. So I think it's a really neat little tool to see how a selector will be applied if you add a little bit of style to it on your theme without having to make guesses, because it will visually show you. So we're not going to do the risky live demo. We'll come back to the risky live demos. The next tool that I use is Firebug. I use Firebug in Firefox. You may happen to use it in Chrome. You may happen to use Internet Web Developers Toolbar. There's lots of other tools. My biggest tool that I use, though, is Firebug. The problem that this tool solves for me and for my students is that when you are trying to figure out which CSS styles are actually being applied, not what you have in your theme, and therefore, of course, it's going to work, but what's actually being applied, Firebug helps to show you, literally, because there's lines crossed through the stuff that isn't being applied, or sometimes it just doesn't show up if you've used the wrong selector. Firebug shows you what styles are being applied on a rendered page. So here we go. We're going to locate the properties of page elements. In this case, the middle arrow is the thing, the page element that I'm looking at. Blue is the inside the CSS box model, that is the content, you know, it's the inner shape. The yellow is the margin, I believe. Padding is purple. Putting the yellow on there. Padding is purple. Yep, thanks. So it's going to show you as a highlight, unlike Fever, which sort of locks that style into place, it's just going to sort of flip around and show you what it is that you're currently manipulating. Now, across the bottom, highlighted, I'm sure it's not legible, but highlighted in perhaps orange, is the actual HTML for that specific line of a rendered web page. And on the right-hand side are all of the applied styles, which through the cascade get applied to that element. The neat thing about this, I had a student recently who I had showed them how to make news articles, and she had renamed it to blog. Completely legit, except all of the selectors that I used relied on the main news or articles or whatever happened to be, and her selectors had not been updated to reflect the content type, which is actually called blog. So by using Firebug, she was able to see that her styles were simply not appearing at all, even though they were in her cascading style sheet. So this was able to show her that there was something else happening, you know, again, in terms of the forensics, preventing her from styling Drupal. This one's a basic web design thing, but people tend to think that once you get to Drupal, you have to leave all of your kit at the door. Bring all your kit in, because a lot of it's going to be incredibly useful. Again, this is a less risky lab demo, just Firebug, but I'll skip the demos to the very end. One of the things that people don't necessarily recognize right off the bat, though, is that you can actually edit what doesn't save, it doesn't lock in any of those changes, unlike Fever, where you can publish them and save them. You can actually manipulate your HTML and CSS, and you can see the full CSS file by clicking the right-hand column, gives you a blue link to that specific style sheet, where you can go and take a look at what's being loaded. Other useful browser tools, web developer toolbar, the IE web developer toolbar. For this kind of forensic, what other tools do you use right now? Anything else? Shout it out. Nothing. Come on now, shout it out. Yeah, Google Chrome web developer toolbar kit extension. Yeah. Fire query. Is that right? Pause because I just have to repeat that back into the microphone for the recording. So Fire Selector allows you to select, search for selectors and see how they're being applied. Is that right? Plugins for Firebug. Yeah. Excellent. Anything else that people are using? Yeah. CSS Edit? Yeah. Is that the one that does the live update whenever you change your CSS file? Yeah. Whiteflow? Okay. What does it do? Performance trends. I'm just saying it again because then it gets recorded. That's all. So it would be kind of weird if I came over and I was like, speak into the lapel. Size of all the images. Yep. Yep. JavaScript, uncompressed, compressed, all that kind of stuff. The part that really cracks me up about people caring about the size of downloads again is that I would say that a third of the community that I live in is still on dial up. And I'm like, so when you're on dial up, and people are like, we're not on dial up, we're on mobile. Any kind of validation tools, spell check, stuff, that stuff, for sure. So it's a great toolkit. It's certainly the stuff that I use. This is the stuff that I use on a daily basis when I'm working with site building for Drupal, my gaming intro classes, that kind of stuff. But as you can see, there's an entire suite of tools. Don't check your toolkit at the door. Like I said, bring it in with you. So now we get on to the actual forensic part where we're digging into Drupal itself from a rendered web page. For this, we're going to use the Themer module. How many of you people have used Themer Info? How many people have never ever heard of it? You guys can tell. All right. So, this is considered the Cadillac of theming tools. My frustration with Themer Info is that it's so powerful that if you're very new to theming Drupal, it's very difficult to tell what you're actually supposed to do with the information that you're getting back from it, which is why I like working with Themer and Firebug on sort of like tiny little edge that just gets around the edge. And then Develop Themer is like, no, I'm cool. I know how to open a template file. I know how to mess with stuff. I'm just dangerous enough that I could use some help with this stuff. So Develop Themer. It's similar to Sweeper in that it's essentially a UI on top of a page that you're going to enable. So down in the bottom right-hand corner, once Themer is installed, Themer Info has a little checkbox that you're going to toggle on and off down in the bottom left-hand corner. Then, just like Sweeper, you're going to click on things. It gives you sort of box wireframes. One of the tricky things about Themer is you sometimes can't physically click on the element that you want to know more about. So it's something to be aware of. Make sure you're actually clicking on the thing that you want to change. And then on the right-hand side, you'll have a window pop up, much like the overlay on Drupal 7. It pops up on top of the screen and gives you more information about the template file or files that are relevant to the thing you clicked on. It will give you, it can actually be the problem. It will give you theme functions, pre-processed functions. Can't read the bottom one. I'm sure you'll have to actually go to SlideShare and read what it says if you're going to install it. Now, the reason So then once you've got that thing, which you're not really sure, great, so I need to edit jplayer.tpl.php. Plug whatever it is in, whatever the thing is that Gamer has told you to manipulate, plug it into Google, and it will tell you what that file actually is, and also api.drupal.org, although new Drupal web builders can get a little bit overwhelmed by it, but it's got some really great documentation as well as comments enabled, much like the php.net does. So either way, identify the thing within Drupal that you're going to need to manipulate, and then go look it up on the internet, and you can go find the file and just start hacking at it as well. But there's some really great information on the web. So the oops on this one is that, if I just skip back for a couple seconds, the very last line of that pop-up window should tell me all of the relevant variables. What you can't see in that screenshot is it says loading bars, loading bars, loading bars, and it doesn't actually ever complete the loading on my laptop. I'm getting some 404 error messages. I'm not sure if that's specific to my laptop or if it's a bug with the current instance of Gamer Info with Drupal 7.7. I'm not really sure, but there will be no risky live demo of Gamer. We'll just have to talk about it in theoretical terms. If someone happens to have a laptop and you can get Gamer Info working, I'm very happy to demo it on someone else's computer, and we can plug your laptop in instead. So those of you who are overachievers, we go. We need to develop and develop Gamer. So, making it easier, generally the way programmers approach Drupal is to go and gather up all the template files and touch them all. It's like, I don't know if you have the car ad over here where the guy licks his hand and then touches the door handle so that he can clean the car. That's the way that we commonly approach theming Drupal or manipulating the theme layer. The problem is, this is where you get into the host exploding or website exploding problem. If you flip this and you think about your content and then think about what you actually need to manipulate, you can save a lot of headaches. This means, I have slides for this later on, but I don't remember the sequence of it, so I'm just going to tell you and then we'll skip past it. This means setting up a really good data model. If you need to isolate specific fields when you are looking at the rendered web page, or if your design assumes that you can move fields around your page, make sure that your content type separates that information out. Don't try and just shove it all into one big body field and then work some kind of crazy JavaScript to be able to eliminate or so or whatever happens to be specific classes or divs or whatever inside the body field. Separate things out as much as possible. Think about how the content will be used. Think about how the site design and the Drupal content types or the Drupal modules, whatever it may be, fit together. So again, don't go around and lick all the template files. Rather, think about the content and therefore which of the template files might you need to manipulate if CSS isn't enough. How many people can empathize with this slide? Yes, and that's because we're in Europe. This is not the land of semantic markup. This is Drupal 7 land. Okay? Now, realistically, what I found is that the North American audiences, they like their big SUVs, they like their big honking divs and classes, all the information they could possibly want. And when I speak to European audiences, I'm not sure how we get from trucks to thongs, but y'all like thongs in your pants. It is. Now, there is the occasional European who likes the North American style and vice versa, so I like to explain this so that people can realize that they're not alone, they were just born into the wrong side of the world, the wrong country. If you care desperately about your markup, remember the slide break beginning that I've become a lazy front-end developer? I no longer care desperately about my markup, although I was originally part of the web standards project. I think you can still find my bio on the WASP site. If you care desperately, you need to start with a better base. Again, you don't need to go and lick all of the template files. Morton has already done that for you. If you know Morton, you'll understand what that slide means. He's coming on Thursday and he'll be out of box. So, you need to start with a better base theme, which means something as clean as mothership. It means something like semantic, if you're still in HTML5 toolkit, there's lots of other modules where people have done most of the work for you to clean up all of the, to clean up most of the most common Drupal markup. We did get a lot better in 7 than it was in 6. We will get a lot better again in 8 as we're moving to HTML5 as a primary theme and into core as well. But again, you don't need to look at all the template files yourself. Right. Finally, theming tools, well, not finally, this is actually a midway point. We're going to go through them quite quickly because it goes like this. Use a sketchbook. Use wireframes. Use a data model. Use a grid framework. But don't just use any grid framework. Use one that doesn't have 16 columns. And if you don't understand why that's relevant, you need to read the book that Mark Golden hasn't actually written yet or finished writing yet. You need to hop on Twitter and tell Mark Golden that if he doesn't finish his book, you're going to use exclusively 16 column grids from now into eternity, so he better finish his book. And if at least one of you do that, you're really happy, because we talked about it earlier today. Ultimately, the advantage of using a grid system, if you're a non-designer like me, is it allows you to very quickly snap into place the columns that you need for your website. The other great thing about using CSS grid framework specifically is that all of the cost riser nonsense has already been dealt with for you. If you happen to be working on very large websites that you have to optimize for various things, you may not want to work with whether it's a 960 or a newsprint, whatever all the different grid frameworks are today. You may want to clean it up to your own use, but it's great for really, really quick websites that will generally work in most browsers. Base themes, I personally have 3 in my toolkit, 960, Fusion, and Zen. Omega is there another way to pronounce Omega? Is it get Omega? It's like aluminium and aluminum? Yeah, right. So I don't use Omega. It's not that it's a bad base theme. It's simply that I have 3 in my toolkit that I currently use. 960 is if I need to spit out a website that's got some columns. I use 960. Fusion, if I need to set up a website where the end user gets to create the blocks and wants to be able to style them, Fusion is great with its formerly Skinner and now Fusion Accelerator is the module that will be coming with Fusion, because that concept allows you from the UI to apply groups of styles. So let's say your website is blue and you have green blocks. You don't need to worry about writing a CSS selector to predict, or which is able to predict, what a block might look like in the future. You simply create a skin or a group of styles that a user can point and click and apply to anything from the UI. It's like Twitter, except a little bit more optimized. And then I would say that's the first base theme that I worked with, and you never forget your first. So, come on, man, that's fair for base themes. How many people have never worked with a base theme? It's okay. So I would say that out of those 3, Zen has the best documentation if you've never looked at a base theme before. However, if you want to try and make 3 columns of equal width, Zen may not be the starting place for you unless you have a lot of experience dealing with content-first, floaty, big-margin website design. In that case, I would actually say start with 960, because 960 allows you to very quickly snap into position a Drupal website. I'll show you a 960 site shortly. And then finally, Fusion. That's if you are at the point where you're a site builder or a site themer, but you're going to hand it off to someone else, and you want them to be able to apply styles without touching code. So if if I'm building a site for myself, I tend not to use Fusion. If I'm building a site and passing it on to someone else, I'm more likely to use Fusion. Any other base modules? There's at least 30 of them. Does anyone have one that they constantly want me to say into microphones that is supportive for future generations? Yeah, let me get it. Any others? And there's that's a session later on. Do you remember the time? That's right. People do tend to have their favorites. I am not going to touch on this at all. I said the word panels in my session description to lure you all in, but I'm not actually going to talk about panels. Let the crying commence. So there's essentially three competing camps for Drupal layer modules. This is alphabetical. Context, display suite, and panels. And they all do same thing from a configuration theme or layer point of view, but in obscenely different ways. You would not guess from looking at the UI, just sort of casually, that they would in any way be connected in terms of their output functionality. I would say try all three of them. Why did I go with panels first? I probably went with panels first. Because I like Earl, I think he's a nice guy, and he gave me free technical support. But I started using panels in 2008, so I was a fairly early adopter, fairly early adopter. Display suite may have existed. Context and spaces, I don't think existed at the time. And again, I tend to stick with the toolkit. Once I've got it, just for simplicity purposes, if you don't have any of those three, check them all out, check out the community, see which one you find best meets your needs in terms of whether it's markup output, whether it's flexibility, panels, I can write my own little plugins, don't use their markup deep fake, it's not ever meant to actually be used as a markup generator. But those are the three to look at. Finally, in terms of the toolkit, find a text editor that doesn't make you want to punch someone in the face. For me, that's Vim. I know that sounds kind of weird. There will be other people who use Emacs, use BBEdit again, I think is hot. TextMate, Komodo, if you're using the full suite, Eclipse, Shutter, some other ones. Roller, PHP something. PHP Storm, thank you. Nano. Notepad Plus. Plus. All right. Komodo. Coda. Coda. Again, I keep saying this, so you may. Yeah. Really, it doesn't matter. I say this with love and affection, but Microsoft Word is not an appropriate text editor. Although, it's only because it makes you want to punch someone in the face. So, now we're going to go through the actual theme of building. The series of theme talks, please don't write any of these down, because again, the slides are already up there, but more importantly, if I skip to that slide one, yeah. More importantly, because you can just grab the theme itself from Drupal.org. So that URL, /project/domicile. So, the basic steps that I go through when building a theme, communicate with your whole team. If you're working with an external designer, ask them to work with a grid, which relates to the CSS grid framework that you're going to be using. It's amazing how much faster life goes when they adjust everything by about 4 pixels. Plan your data structure. Again, make sure that your actual content model that you're inputting data in matches the design that you want to get back out again. Use wireframes, the proof that you're talking about. Wireframes are not just an extra step that we use to charge clients more money. build the site, ignoring the theme. Build it out in Bartek. Convert your wireframe to a grid layout. Build out the HTML fragments in relevant detail.php files, which is basically just page for the minimum viable theme, which is in a second. Apply the theme to your site, and then start digging in and taking a look at what do you actually need to manipulate. Again, this is a beginner session. This is not, the economist gave me $2.4 million to build a website. This is like when you're working at the beginner level of theme in Drupal. So, this is the theme we're going to be looking at. It's described in the book that I've got coming in at the end of September. The theme is online for free. Go and grab it, take a look at it. So here we go. This is what it looks like as a rendered web page. I'm just going to flip through these. I'm not going to describe them. Here's the grid applied, 12 columns. Look at the 16 column one, just to make my copy. This is, I used 960 as the base theme. I really did make a little wireframe to show myself where the divs were going to be and what column width they had applied to them. Some of us can wireframe in our heads. Some of us use sketchbooks. This is Balsamic, which is great because it uses Comic Sans. You know that there's absolutely no way it's a properly designed website because it's using Comic Sans, right? Not a properly designed website, it's just a wireframe. The theme folder gets dropped into sites, and then your URL themes, and then whatever the theme name happens to be. You also need to dump in the base theme. All themes if you're working on a multi-site installation. The theme info file has very little in it. You can read it, it's got a name, a description, screenshot, the version of core, the engine. It's kind of silly that we still include engines because really page template is the only one. It's identified that the base theme is 960, it has exactly one style sheet. And it's got a little debugger thing at the bottom to turn off the 960 wireframe and stuff. Then we've got four regions, and by explicitly setting the features logo, name, and product, save, icon, and favicon, I've turned off all of the other ones. Okay, that's it for the info file. Again, you can download this stuff. My favorite thing, the reason why I keep telling you not to copy is because in Chicago, someone started copying this file, and it doesn't actually show the entire line of code, and I felt really bad. So, in the page.tpl.php file, copy it from the 960 base theme, dump it into your themes folder, and start mucking about with it, but ultimately you're going to be adding those four regions. You're going to, occasionally check back with your design and think about how do I want to place content in. On the rightmost side, in that third column, boxes 4 and 5 are blocks which are dumped in and then content sits above. So you can play around with what's a region versus what's a thing that gets dumped into a region. These are images which have been extracted from the Photoshop document. I no longer talk about slicing Photoshop files. I now think about the PSD file and the website as two independent living documents. Because Photoshop doesn't twist and expand and do things, mostly because I use GIMP, not Photoshop. But if I did use Photoshop, it's a static picture. And so I think about how can I transition this static picture into a fluid web design. And the way I do that is I lift elements out, such as these images, so I extract the images and then place them into my theme folder and hard code them in. So look at your Photoshop file and think about not slicing and dicing and table layout and picture perfect design and all the rest of it, but how can I get that same effect in my web page? Again, and here they are in the actual template file. This is the minimum viable theme. So by extracting and placing four images and doing a tiny bit of markup in page drupal.php, I can get the essence of what I want my site to look like. Now we start the forensic season. Now we start actually identifying, placing content into the site and looking at, I want that thing to be brown, I want this one to be blue, I want the links to line up, however they, now I start experiencing the site and applying relevant cascading style sheets, selectors, properties, all the rest of it. I think the entire, you'll have to double check from the actual theme, but I think the entire style sheet for this theme is less than 200 lines. So it's Drupal 7 plus 960 plus maybe about 20 lines of changes in page.drupal.php and less than 200 lines, and that's what we end up with. It looks nothing like Bartek. But it took very little work because I approached it from a content out point of view instead of running around looking at the template files. And that's what I mean when I can say that this, now it's a very simple site, but it's one that can be built in very little amount of time because I'm thinking about how the content will be experienced. Does this grow with me? Does this, you know, 2 years from now when I've added three times as much content and twice as many blocks and all the rest of it to grow with me? No, but it's that sort of iterative approach. So here we go. The summary of what we've gone through so far. Plan, think, build, test, theme, iterate, all the buzzwords that you can fit in. Do them. Don't just sort of wave your hands and say, we made some wireframes. Look at your wireframes. Think about your content models. Think about how you're constructing your site. Look at the design. Think about how the content's going in and out. And then start cherry-picking the cascading selectors that will help you manipulate the files, that will help you manipulate the rendered design in a useful way. If it isn't going to be enough, then start digging in with DevelFemur and taking a look at what are the template files that I actually need to manipulate to fix this layout. Use relevant Drupal modules to break up content. So, for example, if I want the same block to appear in two different regions, or the same block to appear in the same region on a single page, I know that I use panels for that. You may use something else, but I personally use panels. So again, think about developing a toolkit to accomplish what you need to do to break up the content and redisplay it on the site in a way that can be easily styled. I use Weaver to teach people how to isolate selectors for cascading style sheet files. You may find it useful as well. I personally use Firebug to diagnose and fix CSS problems. I use DevelFemur info to isolate if I actually need to dig into the template files. And then ultimately, make sure that you correlate the amount of time that you're spending on your theme to the budget that you've been given. There's absolutely no sense promising to build something that is exceptionally difficult for the built site if you've been given, you know, half a day to build out the theme or something, whatever your numbers happen to be. Maybe it's for you, it's 6 months, it's a short period of time. But look at how much time or how much budget or what your timeline is allocated, and then go ahead and apply an appropriate amount of energy and touch the fewest number of files. You'll have other people who completely disagree with what I'm saying, but I'm on the stage right now. So, ultimately, for all the time that I've spent with Drupal, I have learned to trust the experts more and back away from the code, step to one side, and come back in with a layer of size over top. For me, this has also meant participating in the Drupal community to make sure that the markup is something I want to receive. You're all at DrupalCon, which implies that you're ready to, you know, a beginner session, so you're ready to, or perhaps dancing around the edges of being part of the community. Take part in that community. Make sure that what you are receiving is something useful so that you don't have to spend as much time to be able to sell your site. All the codes on the right side. So, advanced theming, if you're like, whew, that was a good map. Advanced theming workshop is 24th. I have no idea what day today is. Today is 23rd. Yes, okay, so tomorrow is the advanced theming workshop. There's two boss back-to-back with front-end development folks for themers, which will be more all over the place, all levels of experience welcome. And then I did have as well the other sessions for advanced theming. You should be able to just take a few of your schedule for those ones. Nice. The words didn't show up. It says, what did you think? Go and click on the survey, fill it out. I was going to say, and then the Drupal Association gives you a free iPod, but it's completely a lie. You don't get anything for free when you fill out the session. It just makes me look either really good or really bad. So that's the text that people show up in the slide that DrupalCon provided. But in the bottom left are a bunch of discount codes, and the bottom right is a summary of all of the bots. And I think I have 4 minutes. Or I can be crazy about them and say, well, what? Yeah. Pause. Hang on, pause. Because I'm just going to say it back in. I won't be able to do the whole thing. So very often, an existing theme will get you 98% of the way there, except you've done something that's a little bit off, right? So, you just want to catch it. I really would create a derivative theme because sometimes, and I don't mean it in a negative or positive way, but sometimes themers will come back because their clients have asked for new development, and all of a sudden that theme is now a responsive theme and works for mobile. And if you've hacked that theme, you're going to have to apply all of your hacks now to the new version of the theme. So I would always say, even if you get weird levels of inheritance if you're going multiple levels down. But I would say, as much as you can, don't touch the original code and just do your little sliver. Like Zen is designed as a base theme, and I'm hoping that by the end of the year they'll have their responsive theme out. The less that I've touched within the server kit in terms of making my own complementary CSS files instead of editing theirs directly, the more I can just copy them the new version to the server kit. Other questions? Oh wait, I saw a book sticker that you guys are leaving. Yeah, bye. Yeah, you all have questions there. Go ahead. It really depends how complex the design is and how many page elements there are. I'm not lying when I say that the domicile theme was less than 2 days. But again, that's because I asked Betty to use 960 of all of the resource files. So the Photoshop template that she was using was already set up to use exactly with 960. Some of the ones which take me longer are, I rarely spend more than a week. And that's because I'm not a very strong coder from a JavaScript point of view. So I'll go grab someone else's library in most cases, but the one, if you pull up site3.dev4.webenabled.net, the first word of every heading is a different color, and that took me a few iterations to get right for the JavaScript because my selectors weren't always saying the DOM change. For the headings based on what style of page I was looking at within Drupal. But I'm pretty sure that was still under a week of time with custom JavaScript. And especially with all the sliders and the widgets and the whatnot, a lot of that stuff's already written. And it's just a matter of skinning the jQuery plugin or whatever it is you're working with. So, now, that said, I'm not working on sites for clients much anymore. I'm mostly doing sort of, this is my world because I'm setting up a site for training that I'm going to give to someone else. If you have to do iterations because there's clients involved, which most people work with clients because that's how they get paid, of course it's going to take longer because you'll have that back and forth with the wireframes, you'll have the back and forth with the design, you'll have the back and forth with the live site. So that's, for me, that's just straight time of thing. There's a question. Yep. ask Mark Boulder why he doesn't want to use a 15-grid system. I actually prefer working with 12 because it limits my options. I'm not entirely sure why he thinks 16, but I have a feeling it's for the same reason, that it gives too much flexibility and results in too cluttered a design. You're trying to accomplish too much at the same time. But you'll have to check with him because he's a professional designer. I'm just a lazy front-end coder. Well, he is against, he is against predefined grid frameworks for published sites. He absolutely uses them for quick prototyping. When he redesigned Drupal.org, I think he used Blueprint. Can anyone correct me on that one? Blueprint. So I know that he uses existing frameworks, except he's using them for rapid prototyping. And then when he actually refines and designs, then he'll use something that is related to the actual font that he's using. He's trying to get vertical rhythm. I'll just say some words that I've heard him say now. Tell him to finish his book. And I'm going to make him listen to this afterwards, because he's fabulous. Okay, yeah. I don't put any disclaimers in the proposal to prevent scope creep. What I try and do is, I know that it's not a great thing to do, but I'm more likely to spec out a design that I know I can build quickly in Drupal. So one of the reasons why I'm more likely to spec some things out is I need to make sure that the latest version of whatever my module toolkit is actually works with the other things that they want done. And so I'm more likely to go and check all the project websites, make sure that there's not any massive bugs that I'm aware of. I'm more likely to think about a design and sort of, so if we need to do this data model with those modules, then, once I give them, this is my plan, I put obscene numbers on my change request in terms of how much it's going to cost. And I also encourage my clients to iterate. I do not want to spend 6 months building a website that launches on day 6 months plus one day. I would rather launch a series of features. I think it's better for SEO. I think it's better for if you've got a huge customer base, to suddenly snap the new whatever happens to be on them. But if you release functionality gradually, then you essentially train your user base. They can then train other users. Of course, it depends on the style of website you're building. So I would rather do smaller increments along the way and refine as I go than spend a huge amount of time behind a development server or some kind of privacy wall before I start launching. I don't know if that. Yeah. More like, good luck with that. I'm a trainer now. Yeah. Yeah. The question was, how do I future-proof? Well, I tend to use Palantir as a dev shop in America that works on budgets that I would say are at least 10 times the size of what I, like their average sort of size is easily 10 times the size of what I work on, but I really like the way they approach it. I don't know if they still give this advice. If you start on odd, stay on odd. If you start on Drupal 5, skip 6, go to 7. If you start on Drupal 6, skip 7, go to 8. And that's because they tend to be working with nonprofits. My understanding is they will sit sort of behind the development firewall until it's perfect, they launch it, and then it's essentially a static site, which gets fresh content, but it's not getting huge redesigns every 6 months. I like that approach for the small clients as well, because the last thing, in my experience, and one of the reasons I came to Drupal, is if you tell someone who's just spent what they feel is a lot of money on web development, they don't want to hear 6 months from now that the latest version of some software is available, and they have to upgrade everything. So I tend to keep things sort of in static, especially for a lot of the grant-based work that I've done. So they've got $8,000 now. It's too much money. but they'll have nothing for the next 3 years. So I'm just sort of, you know, well, let's, you know, we can pay all of this now because we've got this whole year in the campus, but let's kind of slowly roll it out and see how you're going to grow with the site, and then not worry about it until you have the next chunk of money. It's not really future-proofing, it's more client management, maybe. It's my hard work. That's the amount of work. Perfect. Yep. Yeah. Yep. Yeah. Yep. Yeah. Yep. Yeah. Secret is a Drupal project. So again, these slides are all up now. I think the session description links to slide share. And the URLs are there for each of the different modules. Yeah. There's a problem with the slides? I'll be up later. Yeah. Come on. I've got one left now. No? Yes. And so the question was, do you work faster with basic? Personally, I work a lot faster with a toolkit that I know. And the base theme for me, again, I sort of talk about some of my three favorites being Ben Fusion and 950. I know them so well, but I know when it's appropriate to use them, and I use them as if they were my own. That said, Morton wrote the base theme Mothership. Because of the way that he approaches front-end development, he needs clean semantic markup to be able to work efficiently. So the fastest way for him to develop was to write his own base theme. And a lot of, I would say, maybe Drupal shops in the range of at least 10 employees will start to develop their own kit, which may be a modification of one of the other existing base themes. Zen came out of Lullabot originally, and is now a Palantir-maintained project. So ultimately, all of those base themes are someone's. And if you find that none of them are quite meeting your needs, you're going to spend more time modifying them each time than creating your own base theme. Other questions? I'm like 5 minutes past, the speaker hasn't shown up to kick me out, so. Oh, I am preventing you from drinking coffee. Get out.